Good morning, and once again, welcome to Faith at Home with Pastor Carla. For today's announcements, there are a few. Please know that for the next 2 weeks, next two Sundays, because of a suggestion of the bishop, we will all be Methodist pastors, and most Methodist pastors will be on renewal leave. So you will still have a worship service. Conference is supplying worship services that will be aired at 10:30 on our Facebook page. So you will still have church, it just won't be Jim and I, and Larry, of course, behind the camera. So please be aware of that. Also, if you have a pastoral emergency, feel free to call. I will be home, but please just limit it to emergencies if you need me. Also, on June 28th, which is the last Sunday in June, Hope will be worshiping at Swayze Mill Park at 7 p.m., and since Governor Murphy has opened outdoor gatherings to about 100 people, I can extend the invitation to those who would like to come. But please, I cleared this with Mayor Tim McDonough here in Hope. He just asks that we follow the basic social distancing rules, and that means, you know, we'll sit 6 feet apart. Please bring your own chair, and I'll be sending out the bulletin. If you can, print out your own bulletin and bring that as well. There will not be a picnic following like we typically do, again, because of social distancing, but it should be, pray for a nice day like today, and it'll be a beautiful time, and it'll just be good to gather together again in worship. So please feel free to join us at Swayze Mill Park, June 28th, 7 p.m. And the last thing is a suggestion I heard through a church member who was having challenges hearing sometimes Facebook, but another church member who only uses our phone connection says, well, use the phone with it. And this church member has found it wonderful. She can connect with the phone and hear it with Facebook. It's a little out of sync, but not too bad. And she goes, it's great. She can hear clearly. So if you're having any issues and would like to try that out, I recommend it. Give it a shot. And hopefully you can hear better, hear the worship more clearly. Okay, with that, let us focus our worship. Please join me in prayer. God of life, God of hope, God of all, lift us on your love like eagle's wings. Sustain us, guide us, heal us in this holy hour. Then send us forth into the world that we may love as you love. Amen. And now, as always, we move into our time of praying for one another. I thank everyone who's sharing on the message section in Facebook of your prayer requests. They have been put on our prayer lists. Keep them coming, and it's great to see how each one is asking for prayers. So, as always, I will start the prayer, leave a time for you to lift up whomever or whatever you would like, and then we will come back together again and pray the Lord's Prayer. So, let us pray. Gracious, loving, almighty God, you who put the planets in their place and yet call us each by name, you are beyond our understanding and you are beyond our capabilities of loving. You bless us each and every day with so much, with strength, with guidance, with peace, with mercy, with all things, Lord, and for your spirit and your presence and all that you give us. We give you our thanks. And that brings us here today, Lord, as we bow our heads before you and just acknowledge you and admit that you are so important to us and we need you in our lives. And we are grateful that you are there and we are grateful to be brought together as your children, as your family of faith. And Lord, we just thank you for your many blessings. Lord, as we gather, there's much that we need to pray for those who are still ill, for those who are needing a recovery, but Lord, also for those who are suffering, for the protesters, for all who have been affected, and just all the violence that is going on in our world and in our country, Lord, we place it all in your hands. For your mind and your thoughts are greater than our thoughts, and we need your guidance, Lord. So bless our leaders, bless this world. May we come to hear your voice and follow faithfully. And now, Lord, as always, we place on your altar the cares and concerns that are on our hearts. and trusting that you hear, that you answer in your way and in your time. Lord, we give you our thanks and praise and ask that for all who may need healing, that you place your healing hand on them and return them to fullness and wholeness of health, you know, giving them more and more strength, helping them grow stronger each and every day. For those who are grieving, we place them in your care and ask that your spirit bring them comfort. For those who are celebrating, many graduations were celebrated this week, not in the traditional way. We just ask your blessing on all the graduates, high school, junior high, college, Lord. It's a major milestone in life. Bless each graduate, and may they continue on the road that you have prepared for them and live the life that you created them to live. Bless each one, Lord, and may they know your presence and be grateful for you in their lives. And Lord, we just lift these prayers to you and offer them in the name of Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today there are two readings. I'm using two different translations. The one from Habakkuk, which, how many have ever heard from Habakkuk? I'm just reading this just to show you how relevant the Bible still is. This is, actually a cousin of mine posted this on Facebook because her pastor was preaching on it. I will not preach on this, but listen. Listen to what this prophet says, and just imagine, to me, this could have been put in tomorrow's newspaper. And it says, Habakkuk writes, "How long, O Lord, must I call for help, but you do not listen? Violence is everywhere. I cry, but you do not come to save. Must I forever see these evil deeds? Why must I watch all this misery? Wherever I look, I see destruction and violence. I am surrounded by people who love to argue and fight. The law has become paralyzed, and there is no justice in the courts. The wicked far outnumber the righteous, and so that the justice has become perverted. And the Lord replied, Look around, all the nations, look and be amazed, for I am doing something in your own day, something you won't believe, even if someone told you about it." I was amazed when I read that and going, wow, it speaks so clearly to today. But now we hear from the Gospel of Matthew, the 18th chapter. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, "Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to seven times?" And Jesus answered, "I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. The servant fell on his knees before him and said, 'Be patient with me,' he begged, 'and I will pay back everything.' And the servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. He grabbed him and began to choke him. 'Pay back what you owe me,' he demanded. And his fellow servant fell on his knees and begged him, 'Be patient with me, and I will pay you back.' But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. 'You wicked servant,' he said, 'I cancel all the debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I have had an honor to. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, last week's sermon, I began it with, it was came from an aching heart. This week's sermon, instead, is coming from a challenging question that came up in Bible study 2 weeks ago. We were focusing on Jesus' question of who needs a doctor, the healthy or the sick? And somehow we got to the question, can only God extend or pour out grace? And it was a very challenging question to answer. I didn't have a clear answer on it. None of us were 100% sure. So I put it out to my clergy friends and said, what would be your pastors tend to have opinions on just about every theological question out there. And on this one, I had none. So I took up the challenge. I thought, it's a great question to ask and a great question to think about. So first thing we need to do is let's define grace. What is grace? And the church defines it as God's unearned, undeserved, unearnable love, forgiveness, compassion, joy, all that kind of thing, all those kind of things rolled into one. When I looked it up in the concordance, there were a number of definitions, but the two that kind of jumped out at me for this sermon was, the first one says, it's of a manner or act, especially one that has divine influence upon the heart and its reflection in life. And the second one just says, it indicates favor on part of the giver and thanks on part of the receiver. So it's, started with that and going, okay, let's see what Jesus said about grace. That was my next part of the process after thinking about the definition. And I was very surprised to find that Jesus never talked about grace. Grace is used 111 times in the New Testament. It's heard of 3 times in the Gospels, in John, all in John. But it's the writer describing Jesus. And it's that part in the first chapter of John that says, and the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, full of grace and truth. And from his fullness we receive grace upon grace. And law came through Moses, but grace came through Christ. That's the only place grace is mentioned in the Gospels. So I decided, okay, the passage I just read from Matthew, since forgiveness is part of grace, not all of grace, but a part of it, and this parable that Jesus gives definitely teaches us about forgiveness, I felt it was a close relationship, that whatever was said about forgiveness in this parable could also be said about grace, since it's part of it. And so we need to dig into this parable to understand what is expected of us. And the first thing to do is to get a better understanding of the parable and almost how absurdly laughable it is that it would have been to the first hearers. It goes to say about how the master is, wants to settle his debts with his servants, and he finds this servant that owes him 10,000 talents. What you need to understand is that a talent was the largest denomination of money in the ancient world. And scholars figure that roughly one talent would have been equivalent to 15 years of a servant's pay. So this servant, aside from the fact how in the heck could you rack up a debt that big, owed the master 150 years worth of pay. Obviously, a made-up number, just meaning above and beyond what is ever possible to repay. And if you notice how quickly the master forgives the servant when he asks, which reflects a lot on God's grace and forgiveness on us. And then goes on, the parable goes on when the forgiven servant meets up with another servant that owes him 100 denarii. Now, a denarii is worth roughly 1 day's pay. in ancient times. So this servant owes 100 days worth of salary to the forgiven servant. And of course, he's not forgiven, the master gets mad and throws him into jail. So what is going on in the main lesson in this parable, because if you remember just before this, Peter was asking, how many times do we have to forgive? And, you know, not seven times, but 77 times, or seven times seven, depending on your translation. And Jesus now gives this parable as a reason to that number of how many times we need to forgive. And I see it as how many times we are called to extend grace. We have been forgiven time upon time. Think back in your life and how many times, you know, has God, you've needed to be forgiven by God. And then maybe we don't extend God's grace, because only God can do that. But we extend grace. If you can define grace as unearned, undeserved, unearnable, love, forgiveness, mercy, joy, and all the things that get rolled into that, that God extends to us. When we claim to be followers of Christ, we claim to want to live as Christ lived. And that what this parable shows us, it teaches us, is that there's a big difference between being a follower and being an admirer of Jesus. Admirers, you know, they praise and they talk about the wonderful things the person they admire about, the person who holds their attention, but that's all they do. They just give praise, but they don't live it. When you claim to be a follower of Christ, that means taking to heart very seriously and with concentration on the ways to live as Christ lived, for the reason Christ lived. One of the commentaries used the word, we are called to imitate Christ, and I really don't like the word imitate, because it's superficial. I see it just as an external action. And maybe that's a good place to start, but to truly be a follower, it means to truly to take to heart. That's back to that definition of grace, where it's a divine influence upon the heart, and it shows as a reflection in life. I like the image of a parade. You can imagine a parade, and Jesus is the center stage in the parade, and his followers would be walking with him and going through all that he goes through. But an admirer of Christ stands on the sidelines and just cheers him on. So in today's parable, in today's question, can only God extend grace? My answer would be, well, God extends God's grace. We are called to extend grace because we have been forgiven 150,000 times. And if God has forgiven us that many times, how simple it should be for us to extend that same to someone else who asks of it from us. So today's question I leave you with is, are you a follower? Or are you just an admirer? Will you live extending grace, or will you just cheer Jesus on from the sidelines? The choice is yours. I pray you choose well and be blessed. Amen.
Thank you.
That's how it is with God's love. We should want to pass it on. Go now and be a true follower of Christ. Go now and bless this world in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.